Welcome back to the 11th installment of my series on Earth's extinction events. Today, we're diving into the Quaternary period, a time of massive environmental change with advancing and retreating glaciations, a time more commonly known as the Ice Age. If you're new to this series, don't worry, this video stands on its own. But if you're curious about earlier mass extinctions, check out the full playlist. If you'd like to dig deeper, I've linked a document in the description with all the sources and image credits used in this episode. The Quaternary period is the current period in Earth's history. It began 2.58 million years ago and continues up to the present day. It includes two epochs, the Pleistocene and the Holocene. The Pleistocene lasted for most of the length of the Quaternary, only ending 11.7 thousand years ago, when the modern epoch, the Holocene, began. As I briefly discussed in my video on the Neogene period, these dates were changed relatively recently. In 2009, the current start of the Quaternary was decided on. Before that, it was 1.8 million years ago. Geologists felt that date was somewhat arbitrary, since the defining feature of the Quaternary is the cycle of glaciations, which began earlier. So, the boundary was shifted to better reflect that and give the period a stronger foundation. More recently, there was a proposal to add a third epoch to the Quaternary, called the Anthropocene, to mark the time when humans became a major force of change on the planet. Suggested starting points range from the Industrial Revolution to nuclear testing in the mid-20th century. But in 2024, geologists rejected this idea. The proposed start was seen as too recent, within a single human lifetime, which doesn't align with how geological time is usually measured. As it stands, the existing Holocene epoch is already by far the shortest in Earth's history, at less than 12,000 years. The Anthropocene remains widely used as a concept in science and culture, but it's not officially recognized as a geological epoch. When we talk about the Quaternary, we're really talking about a world defined by cycles of ice and warmth. Over the past 2.6 million years, Earth's climate has swung back and forth between long, cold glacial periods and shorter, warmer interglacial times, like the one we're living in now. These weren't gentle shifts. Entire ice sheets grew to cover much of North America, Europe, and Asia, then melted away, sometimes within a few thousand years. Sea levels rose and fell by over 100 meters. Deserts appeared and vanished. Rainforests retreated, then surged back. One of the biggest turning points came about a million years ago, in what's known as the Mid-Pleistocene Transition. Before this, glacial cycles happened roughly every 40,000 years. Afterward, they stretched to about 100,000 years and became more intense. This shift didn't just change temperatures. It completely restructured ecosystems across the planet. Life during the Quaternary had to be adaptable, or disappear. Some species moved with the climate, others changed, some just didn't survive. Glacial periods favored cold-adapted giants. Mammoths, woolly rhinos, cave lions, ground sloths, and giant kangaroos. In the warmer interglacials, forests expanded and new species took over. These transitions happened again and again. The vegetation followed the climate too. Where ice advanced, forests vanished and tundra or grasslands took over. When the ice retreated, woodlands crept back in, but not always in the same places or with the same species. What we see in the Quaternary isn't just extinction, it's turnover. Entire faunas and biomes coming and going, shaped by the rhythm of the ice. And it wasn't just life on land that felt the impact. The oceans, especially the shallow coastal zones, were transformed by every glacial cycle. As glaciers expanded, sea levels dropped dramatically, by more than 100 meters in some cases, exposing vast areas of continental shelf. Shallow marine habitats like coral reefs, mangroves, and estuaries were stranded, dried out, or destroyed. These areas are some of the most biodiverse in the ocean, and every glacial advance tore them apart. Then, during the interglacials, The sea came flooding back. Ecosystems had to start again. Reefs reformed, fish populations shifted, and coastlines moved, sometimes by hundreds of kilometers. Given all of this, it's honestly surprising that any coral reefs still exist today. These systems were torn down and rebuilt over and over again, surviving every freeze and flood the Quaternary threw at them. We don't talk about marine extinctions during the Quaternary as much, in part because the fossil record is patchy. But coastal and reef-dwelling species, especially specialists, likely suffered heavily from these repeated environmental resets. Even the deep ocean wasn't untouched, as changes in temperature and ocean circulation cascaded into food webs. So, while the drama of the Ice Age often plays out on land, the oceans had their own version of extinction and survival, just below the surface. But not every ecosystem bounced back. Some species, on land and in the sea, never returned. And that's where the real story of the Quaternary begins. Around 1.2 to 0.8 million years ago, Earth's climate began to change. This period, known as the Mid-Pleistocene Transition, or MPT, marked a shift in the rhythm and intensity of glaciations. Before this, Ice Age cycles occurred roughly every 40,000 years, driven mostly by changes in the Earth's axial tilt. But after the MPT, glacial periods began to stretch to about 100,000 years, longer, colder, and more extreme. The cause is still debated, but it likely involved a combination of factors. It may have been the natural result of the gradual cooling of the planet of the preceding millions of years. It could have been caused by changes in ice sheet dynamics, especially in the Northern Hemisphere. Shifts in carbon cycling and ocean circulation may have amplified climate feedback. It might even have been due to the increasing influence of Earth's 100,000-year orbital cycle, the way our planet's orbit becomes more or less elliptical over time. This cycle has always been present, but it hadn't dominated the climate until this point. Before the MPT, shorter and stronger cycles, like changes in the Earth's tilt every 40,000 years, had a bigger effect. After the transition, something shifted. The climate system started responding more strongly to the longer, weaker eccentricity cycle, leading to longer, deeper glaciations. It could have been any of these factors, a combination of them, or none of them. No one really knows. Whatever the cause, the effect was profound. Ice sheets became more persistent and massive, dramatically altering sea levels, rainfall patterns, and vegetation belts. These weren't gentle nudges. They were global environmental upheavals. The MPT didn't trigger a single sharp extinction, but over time, it reshaped ecosystems. Some species adapted to the harsher cycles. Others slowly disappeared. In Africa, for instance, several lineages of large herbivores went extinct or were replaced, including forms of elephants, hippos, and antelope that had thrived under the earlier, more stable conditions. In Eurasia, early species of rhinoceros and deer declined, while more cold-adapted megafauna, like mammoths and woolly rhinos, rose to prominence. In the plant world, long cold periods fragmented forests and reshuffled entire floras. Tundra and steppe became dominant biomes across much of the Northern Hemisphere, favoring hardier, drought and cold-tolerant species. Ecosystems had to repeatedly shift between forest and grassland modes, often within just a few thousand years. So, while it wasn't an extinction event in the classic sense, the MPT was a major faunal and floral turnover, with winners, losers, and complete ecological retools every glacial cycle. While climate and ecosystems were shifting dramatically, humans were also undergoing major changes during the mid-Pleistocene transition. This period was a critical time for the genus Homo, which had already been around for hundreds of thousands of years. Multiple human species lived across Africa, Europe, and Asia, including early forms like Homo heidelbergensis and later ancestors of Neanderthals and modern humans. The harsher and longer glacial cycles of the MPT created new challenges, shrinking habitable areas, changing food sources, and fragmented populations. Some scientists believe that these pressures led to a population bottleneck, a significant reduction in the number of early humans, possibly down to just a few thousand individuals worldwide. This would have made human populations vulnerable, but also could have accelerated evolutionary change, pushing innovations in tools, social behaviours, and adaptability. One of the tools that persisted through this period was the Acheulean hand axe. These teardrop-shaped stone tools had already been in use for over a million years, but they were still being widely made and used during the Mid-Pleistocene. Interestingly, some examples from this time begin to show signs of refinement, thinner edges, more symmetrical shapes, and more standardized forms. These subtle improvements may reflect growing skill or even early cultural traditions in how tools were taught and made. In a world of growing environmental pressure and uncertainty, even small innovations could mean the difference between persistence and collapse. In many ways, the mid-Pleistocene transition was a crucible for our ancestors, shaping not only who survived, but also setting the stage for the rise of Homo sapiens in the following hundreds of thousands of years. The mid-Pleistocene transition reshaped the planet's climate systems and the ecosystems that depended on them, but the world didn't settle into a new equilibrium. Instead, the instability continued to build, culminating in the most famous extinction event of the Quaternary, the loss of the megafauna. Over the course of tens of thousands of years, species that had once defined the Ice Age, mammoths, giant ground sloths, woolly rhinoceroses, diprotodons, saber-toothed cats, vanished. Some disappeared slowly, others seemed to collapse in just a few years. But in either case, by the end of the Pleistocene Epoch, 11,700 years ago, they were gone. And just like with the mid-Pleistocene, this extinction wasn't driven by a single cause. It was the result of two major forces colliding, the end of the last glacial period and the spread of modern humans across the globe. The late Quaternary megafaunal extinctions saw the disappearance of some of the most iconic creatures of the Ice Age. Giant mammals that had roamed the planet for millions of years suddenly vanished, or were pushed to the brink. Across North America, woolly mammoths and mastodons, giant beavers, and saber-toothed cats disappeared. In South America, giant ground sloths, glyptodons, giant armadillo relatives, and other megafauna were lost. Australia's unique giants, including giant kangaroos, enormous wombat-like diprotodonts, and large monitor lizards also vanished. Even in Eurasia and Africa, where some large mammals survived, many species were lost or severely reduced. These animals were not just big, they played crucial roles in their ecosystems. Their extinction reshaped landscapes and food webs, triggering cascading effects that are still felt today. In parts of the Asian steppes, for instance, scientists have proposed reintroducing hardy grazing species, like bison or even cold-adapted elephants, to mimic the ecological functions once performed by mammoths, breaking up snow, dispersing seeds, and maintaining grasslands. The same biotech company that proclaimed they'd brought back dire wolves has also recently unveiled their so-called woolly mice, an early step towards engineering cold-adapted elephants that they are, of course, going to insist on calling mammoths. I've made a full video on their direwolf announcement if you're curious. It's a reminder that the absence of the megafauna is more than symbolic. It left real, ongoing voids in the fabric of ecosystems. The end of the Pleistocene was a time of rapid and dramatic change. After thousands of years of glacial advances and retreats, the last ice age began to thaw around 20,000 years ago. Temperatures rose, ice sheets melted, and sea levels climbed, reshaping continents and ecosystems. These shifts caused major changes in habitats. Tundra and steppe-like environments shrank, replaced by forests and wetlands. Many animals that thrived in cold, open landscapes suddenly found their homes disappearing. Food sources became less reliable, and ecosystems grew more fragmented. But climate alone doesn't explain everything. Some megafauna survived in refuges, while others vanished, even in areas where conditions seemed suitable. The speed and scale of extinction hint that additional factors were at play, most notably the arrival and spread of modern humans. Around the same time as the megafaunal extinctions, modern humans, Homo sapiens, were spreading across the globe. From their origins in Africa, they migrated into Europe, Asia, Australia, and eventually to the Americas. With humans came new pressures on animal populations. Hunting by skilled humans, combined with habitat changes caused by fire and other activities, may have pushed vulnerable species over the edge. This idea is often called the overkill hypothesis. While climate change set the stage, human hunting likely accelerated extinctions. Some species vanished shortly after humans arrived in their regions. Others survived longer but declined in numbers. The interaction between climate shifts and human activity remains a key area of research and debate. What's clear is that the late Quaternary extinction was not caused by a single factor, but by a complex web of environmental and biological changes, with humans playing an increasingly important role. The late Quaternary megafaunal extinction was a turning point in Earth's history. It marked the loss of many of the Ice Age's most iconic animals and reshaped ecosystems across the globe. While climate changes created tough new challenges, it was the arrival and spread of humans that likely sealed the fate for many species. This complex interplay of nature and humanity reminds us how interconnected life and environment truly are, and sets the stage for the ongoing story of life on Earth that continues to today. I hope you enjoyed this video. The Quaternary period is a remarkable chapter in Earth's history, a time when shifting climates, advancing glaciers, and evolving life combined to reshape the planet in profound ways. From the Mid-Pleistocene Transition to the dramatic loss of the Ice Age giants, this period tells a story of change, challenge, and survival. Next week, we'll return to one of my more traditional videos, a genus that's been shaped by both wild mountain slopes and thousands of years of human hands. But for this extinction series, we have just one final installment, the Holocene Epoch and the extinction crisis unfolding today. Thanks for watching, and as always, I'd love to hear your thoughts in the comments below.